I do know that children actually is a bulk of cases that actually use a lot of insurance and admissions. And there is a lot of issues with certain insurance where they actually put a cap about how many times that they can be admitted. And then there'll be an issue when they really need to be admitted that they have problems with payment and things like that. So first, I thought, okay, let's just talk about common illnesses. But it's too much, too many. It wouldn't get to the point that I'm trying to make. So I decided to choose, I decided to choose one bulk, respiratory infection. Okay, so lung infection, upper airway, lower airway. So I'm just going to talk about that. That is the most common cause of admission to the ward. Okay, so just for your understanding, when we talk about children, the difference between children and adults is that their immunity had not matured yet. So this is a very good slide to just show the first year of life that the initial 6 months, they are actually protected by the mother's immunoglobulin. Okay, so there's some protection, especially if they are breastfed. Okay, but it will start to decline and be the lowest about 6 months. So if you notice that, if you have children, that most of the time, the first 3 months, they're well. Very rarely, less than 3 months old get admitted. But when they start going to the nursery, my parents usually start sending their children to nursery or babysitter, 6 months is the time that they start coming in. So all of us will simply say, oh, start nursery, they have problem, cough, cold all the time. But it's a multifactorial reason. One is that the immunity is at the lowest. Second, of course, their exposure to other kids. Okay, so that's what makes them coming to clinic more often. And it only starts to, they only start making it, making their own immunoglobulin, and only reach about 70-60% by 1 year. So, if you notice what KKM is looking at, children illnesses less than 5, if anything happened to them, like death under 5 years old, is something that they will, is a big huge deal. So for us, we'll be so scared if we have a death less than 5 years old, be called for meetings and things like that. And there's a reason to that, because we know that they are the most vulnerable age group. Okay? Okay, so I'm just going to focus on just respiratory illnesses. So it can be something very mild, cough, cold, to someone who just need an extra help, normal ward kind of setup, or up to the ICU setup. Okay? So respiratory infection in children can be very mild to very severe. It's the most common cause of illness among children. And if you've seen forms signed by doctors, a lot of doctors, especially in emergency side or GPs, they usually sign it off as URTI. URTI most of the time. It's a very general diagnosis. It's not actually from where I learned, it's not a diagnosis. It just states that it's an upper respiratory tract illness, but it doesn't tell you where, okay? And it doesn't tell you, okay, it can be simple cough cold that does not require admission, to a very bad tonsillitis that requires admission, okay? Their main presentation usually, fever. Most of the time, high-grade fever, 39, 40 degrees. They have cough, cold, blocked nose. Sometimes can be quite severe. They have trouble breathing, or you hear noisy breathing, like wheezing, or someone that like a snoring sound, what we call stridor. So that tells us where, which level are they actually having problems with, okay? So URTI is at the upper respiratory tract. So it stops somewhere at the trachea, all right? Lower respiratory tract is when it comes to going into the lungs, okay? So I'm showing a lot of pictures. I don't like to put words. And I'm going very like medical, so that you see what I'm seeing, okay? So you can stop me and ask questions if you want. So when it comes to upper respiratory tract infection, anywhere along this line. So this nice arrow is to show the movement of air. And you know respiratory illnesses is spread through the air that we breathe in, okay? So if you imagine the infection going through either the nose or the mouth, if they breathe through their mouth, and get stuck at any point from here to here, all right? The most common diagnoses are put at the side. Flu illnesses can be just normal common cold to influenza. Okay? Acute pharyngitis, which is somewhere just behind the throat. Okay? Tonsillitis, beyond it. Croup, if you ever heard about croup, or the more scientific name is laryngeal tracheal bronchitis, they usually have this very barking-like cough, dry cough, a 6 months old coughing like an old man. Okay? And they can sometimes be quite severe. Or L, epiglottitis. Okay? So there'll be some pictures after this, real pictures. Eh? So what you see is this. That's all you see. Okay? The majority of the time, parents only see the face, or they're being a bit weak at home, they don't want to eat, they're rejecting, or they cough until the point that they vomit, high fever, and look miserable. This is what you see. Okay? For us, when we see this, okay, the child looks ill. But there are times when they look like this, when they have stuffy nose, you unblock it, they're fine. There are times when they are having fever, they are a bit weak, but once you give paracetamol, fever go down, they start running around until the next fever comes back. Correct? But some just remain that way and progresses. So this is when, for us, the history of how they present and how they behave in between the episodes of fever is very important. So that would tell us, okay, you look well enough to be treated at home, or I think you should be admitted. Okay? This is just a picture to show the throat. Okay, this is what we call pharyngitis. The tonsil is behind, but it's not swollen. Okay, so this is the front part. Majority of the time, the kids, when they have such great pharynx, it's very painful. Okay, and so they reject feeding. When they reject feeding, accompanied by high fever, they become more dehydrated. They lose the water. They become dehydrated. They become lethargic. When they become dehydrated, they don't pee, and then it will disrupt the whole system. So sometimes, if they can't take orally, they need admission. Okay? A bit of drip, control the temperature, they'll turn around. Sometimes, if we think that they're not so bad, they're not lying all the time, a bit of medication to soothe the pain, they'll be able to drink, fine. They can be nursed at home. This is tonsillitis with what we call exudate. Some doctors will actually put the proper diagnosis. So they put this, the diagnosis of this as acute exudative tonsillitis. This needs IV antibiotics. If you don't treat this, the toxin from the bacteria can really affect the heart and can spread and can cause severe, what we call sepsis, like infection in the blood and toxic syndrome and things like that. So these type of cases, you don't play lah. Sometimes, we, for adults sometimes, or older children, above 5 years old, they're usually quite okay. So we can give a trial of oral antibiotics. But for the younger ones, when their reserve is very low, they usually don't do very well with just oral, okay? This is just a cartoon, because we rarely that we manage to capture real footage of croup. Croup, as I mentioned earlier, from the larynx, where near the vocal cord, down to the trachea, mainly this area. So when you have an infection, what happens is there's inflammation, okay? Radang. Inflammation, upper, what happens is that there'll be swelling. When it's swollen, it becomes red, and they produce a lot of secretion. So a nice, ini vocal cord ni tempat nak bernafas eh. So when you take a breath, the vocal cord will open up. But when you have infection, it becomes all swollen up. And you have secretion, it blocked it more. So you get a very narrow airway. It can be mild, that can most of the time treated as outpatient, to moderate and severe. But sometimes you have already KIV having Dr. Bashir or Dr. T, our anesthesiologist, standing by KIV for intubation with unable to reverse the swelling. Okay? So you can imagine this area, tight, swollen. It's not something dislodged where you can just take it out. It's something that you have to reduce the inflammation to help them breathe. Okay? This is epiglottitis is something that I always dream not seeing. because if the heart rate goes up, my heart rate also goes up. In acute epiglottitis, epiglottis is here, okay? It's like a doorway to your lung, macam pintu. So when you breathe in, it opens up, you see the vocal cord, the air goes in. When you eat, it closes the airway so that the food goes into your stomach. So it prevents foreign things to go into your lung. Okay, that's the function of epiglottis. So when you have an inflammation, an infection of epiglottis, it becomes swollen, red. So can you imagine what happens? This is a nice one. This is the vocal cord that I mentioned earlier, right? And this is the epiglottis that is swollen. There's already a tube there. Okay, so they are already, we put a tube there so that it can open up the airway so that the child can breathe. So this is an emergency. They are usually very, very ill. They come, they're breathing like that because they won't talk, they won't move, they won't do anything because they are concentrating. I just need to maintain this open. So they won't move. Sometimes they drool a lot. They are so scared to take anything in. Okay? So they're very ill. So this is an emergency. Most of the time you need ENT, you need NS, you need PEDS. All in. Okay? Okay. Question about upper respiratory tract. Just in an illustration of when people put URTI, there's more to just URTI. Okay? Okay, then lower respiratory tract infection is as common as the upper respiratory tract infection. Upper respiratory tract infection, usually they end up seeing GPs dulu. Very rarely they come to PEDS. But lower, they do. Okay? So the three most common infection is acute bronchitis. Mostly adult acute bronchitis, sometimes children do. Acute bronchiolitis and bronchopneumonia. So anatomically, so lower airway is here, okay? So bronchioles is the two yang separate into right and left. Bronchioles are the smaller stem. Ni macam pokok yang temadi lah, eh? Smaller stem. And the bronchopneumonia is affecting the lungs, okay? So the small area where it like a balloon, where the air goes in and out. So if you can imagine the bronchus having infection, swelling, a lot of secretion, tightening of the airway. So most of the time, children that comes with bronchitis, they also have very dry cough. They usually show chest pain and having trouble breathing. Because it means that this is the main airway. It means that air can't go into the lung. When air cannot go into the lung, you don't have oxygen CO2 change. Okay? So they become very breathless. Bronchiolitis, because it's towards the end, it depends on how many area that is affected. So sometimes one lung can still sustain them. But they usually come with wheezing, difficulty breathing, and a lot of secretion. Whereas pneumonia is towards the end. So if it involves all these bubbles here, involves half of the lung, it's like half of the lung is not functioning now. Okay? So when a doctor put a diagnosis, it kind of like tell us lah, for us, tell us the duration of illness, the management, how the management is going to be like, so we can gauge how many days in the ward and things like that, and whether is it really necessary to be admitted or not. Okay? So just the illustration, this is how a bronchiolitis looks like. Because of the blockage at the stem going to the lung, air can go in but air cannot go out. So they behave like an asthmatic. So as the air going in, the risk is it can burst. Okay? Whereas pneumonia, the lung collapse because it's filled with secretion. So the lung can't open up. So no gas going in and out. Okay? So all the diagnoses that we made, if we don't treat them, they can progress. Okay? Simple common cold usually are viruses, usually they get better. No issue. So most of the time we say, you just take a paracetamol, some medication, you'll get better soon. But there's more severe ones, if you don't treat, it can progress. And it can cause respiratory arrest, means that they can just, you know, they be breathing and breathing and breathing, and they're getting more and more, working harder and harder, that they decided, you know what, I'm tired, and they just stop. Okay? Children do that. Okay? Respiratory failure means the function of the lung where you take oxygen and you blow out CO2. So when you fail, means that you can't take enough oxygen and you can't blow out your CO2. So that will disturb the system of the brain, the heart, and things like that. And heart failure, because the heart and the lungs, they are just next to each other, and they work together. So if you notice, when a child is unwell, if you put your hand at their chest, you can feel the heart rate goes up. Because the heart is trying to help the lung. You're not taking enough oxygen, so I'm going to pump a bit harder so that the brain, the kidney and all that will get the oxygen that they need. You only can supply me this much, so let's do a quick turnaround. After a while, they get tired too. So they can also fail. Alright? So this is what we are trying to prevent. So when they come early, early treatment will prevent them from going through this. Okay? So usually, management, I classify it as this. First of all, we'll manage the symptom. Symptom of fever, cough, runny nose, and all that. So the cough medicine, the runny nose medicine, paracetamol, things like that. Okay? That usually alleviate the parents' stress. They don't see anything else, they only see those things. So those medication kind of calm them down a bit. But you still need to treat the real reason behind it. So if it is a bacterial infection, then you need antibiotics. If it is viral, depends on the type, like influenza, we have antiviral. Other viruses, usually you don't have antivirus. You just have to wait and support the child until they get better, all right? Supportive treatment depends on how severe the infection is affecting them, like oxygen supplementation with the nasal prong, or they actually need more than that, like ventilation and things like that. And then, of course, just because they got better from that episode doesn't mean that it goes off. Sometimes the infection has gone off, but they still have the cough. And the cough can continue for 2 to 3 weeks. And you have to make sure that they get better. Because you can't allow the child to continue coughing forever. Okay? The beauty thing about children's lung is that it continues to develop new cells up to 9 years old. So if they get bad infection now, at maybe about 1 year old, doesn't mean that they're going to end up being asthmatic unless you ignore that they have been coughing away from the last infection. So you want them to get better so that they can produce new cells because they are growing, so the lung needs to grow with them. If we ignore that, then they end up with a smaller lung, so they will have problems during adulthood. Okay? So that's when the rehab and follow-ups happening. Okay? It's finishing soon. So prevention. For you guys, it's mainly practice good hygiene. Hand washing is very important. Teaching your children to hand wash is important. They're less than 5 years old, they don't really think of dirt that much. They just touch everything and touch their face. They just do this and things like that. Sometimes they feel that they are being very kind. They just share their straws and bottles. They share their spoon with their friends. Okay? Sometimes they feel that they wanted to swap their friend and things like that. So, but the thing is, they are also putting themselves to be the host to actually spread things. So for us, it is our responsibility to teach our young ones that it's not that you're being rude not sharing, but it's just that you need to know the boundaries and how to be clean. So after the HFMD outbreak recently, the schools have been teaching the young ones to wash their hands and things like that. So that's, I guess, the blessing in disguise. I don't know. Good nutrition and active lifestyle is very important to increase their immunity. So, and again, less than 5 years old are the worst eaters. Some of them eat too much, not exercising. Some of them are very picky. When you're becoming picky eaters, you don't get the enough nutrition, vitamins that help to protect yourself from infection. Okay? So they rarely take vegetables and they don't take fruits enough. So, having this good nutrition and active lifestyle is very, very important. I think active lifestyle not much of an issue, kan? They're always running around lah. Eh? Smoking. Being second-hand smoker, not good for their lungs. It's actually restricting and making it worse for them, as even up to teenagehood, they might already have a problem if they are second-hand smoker. So, preferably stop smoking for parents, whoever at home, or really go far away from your children. Come back, don't touch your children first. Go change your clothes and all that because it actually sticks. And when your child comes back, when you come back from work, they come running to you, you give them a hug, you're transmitting the toxin to them. Okay, so that's not good for them. And of course, vaccination is also a method of actually preventing them from getting respiratory infection. And nowadays, we are seeing more and more cases of influenza. Unfortunately for Malaysia, influenza is not seasonal anymore. It's all year round. And it will peak when there's heavy rain and hot. You know, you have that. In a day, you can be very hot and then suddenly rain. That's when the viruses will come out. So you, if you notice these last 2 weeks, you've been having a lot of URTIs, a lot of pneumonias, a lot of AGEs, gastroenteritis, diarrheal apnea problems, fever with rash. We are having a lot of these cases right now. And pneumococcal vaccine, I think the government had mentioned about bringing in pneumococcal vaccine as part of the requirement for KKM immunization. But I think it'll take years because of the costs and the budgeting and all that. Okay? So just to share with you. Vaping, actually, they have come up with studies to show that one of the things about vaping is that we're talking about some have filters, some doesn't, number one. Number two, they're not sure about the safety with the chemical in the vape itself. Instead, they were saying that the depends on what you take, the chemical itself can actually cause problem to your own airway. So any smoke for me is considered not good. Because it's considered as an irritant when someone, a secondhand smoker, doesn't go through filters. Okay? As compared to someone who takes it directly. Secondhand smoker does not go through filters. So they will inhale it directly. And for young lungs, young airways, they are very naive. So you will want to protect them from this stuff. Okay? So my last slide, actually, just to show you. The one in green is what the government is giving all our children. The one in pink are considered optional. Among all this, the one I circle is actually protecting you from the type of infection that can cause bad pneumonias, pneumonitis, respiratory infection. So this alone shows that, you know, you wouldn't want to get this firsthand. Because if you know that pertussis is going up within our community, you know the one that they keep on showing the picture with the white thing coming out, not pertussis, that is diphtheria, causing the closure of the airway. So that is diphtheria. D stands for diphtheria. P, pertussis, batuk kokol, 100 days cough. A child can cough for 100 days. Okay. Measles really can attack your lung. They usually are ventilated. Mom's measles, okay. Pneumococcal, I would say if I see a pneumococcal pneumonia, they are usually in HDU or ICU. Usually I don't see them in general clinic. Okay. Influenza, we are seeing it a lot now. Okay. Chickenpox can also cause inflammation to the lung. And they are scary because they can spread very easily. So think about this. Meningococcal can also cause problems to the lungs. So it's just to show that it's so common, and majority, severe one can be prevented by just doing vaccination. Thank you very much.